Blackstone Publishing presents The Divine Plan, John Paul II, Ronald Reagan, and the Dramatic End of the Cold War by Paul Kengor and Robert Orlando. This book is read by Donald Corren. I've always believed that this blessed land was set apart in a special way, that some divine plan placed this great continent here between the two oceans, to be found by people from every corner of the earth, people who had a special love for freedom. President Ronald Reagan, January 31, 1983. The only true freedom, the only freedom that can truly satisfy, is the freedom to do what we ought as human beings created by God according to His plan. Pope John Paul II, September 10, 1987. Prologue. Two Actors in a Divine Plan. Scene 1, Washington Hilton, March 30, 1981, 2:27 p.m. President Ronald Reagan has just completed a speech before the AFL-CIO in Washington, D.C. A crowd gathers outside the hotel to catch a glimpse of the president before he climbs into his motorcade. One young man in the crowd, John Hinckley, has other ideas. The deranged Hinckley has decided to make a dramatic bid for the attention of a Hollywood actress named Jodie Foster, his obsession. Reagan hears what sounds like firecrackers. Suddenly, amid screams, Secret Service agent Jerry Parr shoves Reagan into the back seat of the presidential limousine. Parr lands on top of the president. "Jerry, get off," Reagan says. "I think you've broken one of my ribs." But the pain does not come from Parr. It comes instead from a razor-sharp bullet that has sliced near Reagan's heart, a bullet Hinckley had fired from his revolver. At Parr's command, the driver abandons the plan to return to the White House and whisks Reagan to George Washington University Hospital. The president is bleeding severely. Ronald Reagan is in mortal danger. Scene 2. St. Peter's Square, Vatican City, May 13, 1981, the feast day of Our Lady of Fatima, just past 5 p.m. Only 6 weeks after the shooting of President Reagan, Pope John Paul II is riding in a small, white, open-air Fiat, better known as the Popemobile, greeting the thousands who have come to cheer him. One man in the crowd has been waiting all day for his chance. Mehmet Ali Adza of Turkey carries a Browning 9mm semi-automatic handgun. As the pontiff draws close, Adza lifts the gun and fires 4 times. He hits the Pope in the hand and in the abdomen. John Paul II collapses into the arms of his aides. Father Stanisław Dziwisz, his close assistant and fellow Pole, asks the Pope where he has been hit. "In the stomach," the Pope replies. "Does it hurt?" "It does." Adza begins running. But Sister Letizia, a tough Franciscan nun from Italy's Bergamo region, grabs him. Little does Adza know, but the sturdy nun pinning him down is saving his life. His communist friends, who planned the attack, expect to greet him in the getaway truck with a bullet. They are not about to let their hired lackey live with this secret or their cash. As the historian Craig Shirley observes, first rule of political assassination is to kill the assassin. Meanwhile, security officials get the Pope into an ambulance and rush him to Gemelli Hospital. Rome's brutal traffic makes the task almost impossible, but the ambulance finally reaches the hospital with only minutes to spare. When the patient arrives, doctors find that he is bleeding severely. His blood pressure is plummeting. Father Dziwisz administers last rites. John Paul II is dying. Adza and his Bulgarian and Soviet handlers have set out to kill the Pope, but the divine plan has something else in store. Kinship. A Catholic Pope from Poland, a Protestant president from America's heartland, a priest and philosopher, a Hollywood star and politician. At first glance, Pope John Paul II and President Ronald Reagan seem to have little in common. But look closer. A careful examination of the Pope and the President reveals many parallels. Some of these parallels, as we will see, involve biographical details. For example, their mothers both experienced major health crises when the boys were 8 years old. Their fathers died just 2 months apart in 1941. They both took unconventional paths to their positions of prominence. The similarities run deeper, however. John Paul II and Reagan displayed a spiritual kinship that drew them to each other. That kinship began with a shared understanding of the reinforcing relationship between faith and freedom. It comes as no surprise that the Pope held this view, but this perspective animated Reagan as well. He did not take a narrow view of freedom as meaning merely leave me alone. As president, he spoke of the twin beacons of faith and freedom, and said that freedom cannot exist alone without faith. Yes, Ronald Reagan was a man.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.